everyone. I'm Michelle Long. It's 9 in Manila, 10 in Tokyo, and 9 p.m. in New York. The headlines. Asian stocks set to fall after another hot inflation print in the U.S. torpedoes hopes for an interest rate cut happening soon. Here at home, the stock market resumes trade following a two-day holiday break. The PSE index kicking off from 67.41. And despite a later and less expectation for Fed rate cuts this year, BMI, a unit of Fitch Solutions, is sticking to its forecast for 75 basis point cuts in the second half of the year for the Philippine Central Bank. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. now in Washington for the trilateral summit with the U.S. and Japan. He's expected to bag at least $100 billion in investment pledges. We're also waiting for February's jobs numbers out any time now. We're coming from 4.5% unemployment rate and 13.9% underemployment rate from January. We'll bring you the numbers as soon as they become available. And a talk on jobs and wages in the Philippines with Ibon Foundation's Executive Director, Sunny Africa, later on in the program. We begin with the president's trip to America. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. has arrived in Washington. He arrived around 8 a.m. Manila time for that historic trilateral summit with the U.S. and Japan. Now, that summit is widely expected to focus on China's maritime incursions as the three countries seek to deter Beijing's aggressive behavior. Marcos earlier said the Philippines will strengthen its cooperation with the two countries, both on the economic and security fronts. Aside from the trilateral summit, Marcos will also hold a bilateral meeting with Biden and meet with American investors during the trip.
It is my intention also to exchange views with my U.S. and Japanese counterparts on various regional security issues of mutual concern, while continuing to reiterate the importance of upholding the rule of law and preserving the rules-based international order in the Indo-Pacific region. I intend to explore ways of advancing cooperation, especially in the areas of critical infrastructure, semiconductors, digitalization and cybersecurity, critical minerals, renewable energy, as well as defense and maritime cooperation.
The Philippines seen bagging huge investment deals during the historic trilateral summit in Washington. Philippine Ambassador to the U.S. Jose Manuel Romualdez says the U.S. and Japan are expected to pour in at least $100 billion into the country over the next 5 to 10 years. The investment package will cover various sectors including energy, semiconductor, and infrastructure.
This meeting is not only important, but it is also significant. Aside from the defense strategies that we have put in place, the enhancement of our economic cooperation with Japan and the United States is just as important. The energy exploration, of course, which involves the West Philippine Sea, is also is part and parcel of what we're looking at as to bump up our energy requirements, which should be which is increasing every year.
Washington was Manila's fourth largest source of foreign direct investments last year, amounting to $110 million. It also ranked as the Philippines' third biggest trading partner, with a total trade of nearly $20 billion. Japan, meanwhile, is the Philippines' largest source of official development assistance, or ODA, with nearly $13 billion in aid, or about 40% of the country's total portfolio. Welcome news, especially since the Philippines is coming from FDI net inflows that actually jumped 90% in January to $907 million. President Marcos also seeking investments from nuclear power companies on the sidelines of the trilateral summit. Philippine Ambassador Jose Manuel Romualdez says he will be speaking with several companies, including American firm UltraSafe Nuclear Corporation. Marcos earlier said he sees nuclear energy becoming a part of the country's energy mix by 2032. Last year, the Philippines and the U.S. signed a landmark agreement that would facilitate cooperation on the peaceful use of nuclear energy.
The more exciting part of the clean energy projects that we're trying to lure into the country is the small modular nuclear power plants. We have 7,640 islands, and this is going to be perfect for us. It's much safer, it's cleaner, and at the same time, it is a very new technology.
Over now to markets. Asia primed for early declines, largely mirroring Wall Street's lackluster finish after another hot U.S. inflation print supported the view that the Federal Reserve will keep rates higher for longer, with markets pricing in just two cuts this year starting September. That is less than the most recent Fed dot plot indicated. Taking a look at the board now, wow, bleeding across the board from Japan to South Korea to Australia, all in the red. Even futures for Hong Kong tumbling this morning. Asian currencies as well, mostly softer against the greenback. Now, on tap for today would be Australian inflation expectations, consumer and producer prices for China, as well as trade figures from the Philippines. While markets in Indonesia, Malaysia, India, Pakistan, Sri Lanka, and Bangladesh are closed for holiday. Stateside, U.S. futures are also pointing lower. U.S. stocks fell sharply on Wednesday after key inflation data for March came in hotter than expected. The consumer price index increasing to 3.5% year over year. That is the highest since September. It's also up from just 3.2% in February. That's as elevated housing inflation and higher gasoline prices kept readings stubbornly high. And because it remains above policymakers' long-term target of 2%, there is growing speculation that the much-anticipated rate cuts will happen later and less. U.S. President Joe Biden, however, not losing hope.
I do stand by my prediction that before the year is out, there'll be a rate cut. This may delay it a month or so. I'm not sure of that. We don't know what the Fed is going to do for certain. But look, we have dramatically reduced inflation from 9% down to close to 3%. We're in a situation where we're better situated than we were when we took office, where inflation was skyrocketing. And we have a plan to deal with it.
Of course, this world markets, as expected, the Dow seeing the biggest drop of about 1.1%. The S&P also sliding nearly by 1%, and the tech-heavy Nasdaq tumbled over 0.8%. Now, equity prices were further pressured by benchmark Treasury yields, which breached 4.5% to touch the highest level since November.
Markets really moving all on the inflation data, where investors are really having to grapple with the potential for many fewer Fed rate cuts, which is pushing interest rates up along with higher inflation expectations. And on the equity side of the ledger, despite the fact that we had good earnings coming out of Delta, the challenge is higher interest rates mean lower price earnings multiples, and that's really where the pressure is showing up today.
Now, in highlights from corporate America, U.S. President Joe Biden reiterating his support for American workers' opposition to Nippon Steel's bid to acquire U.S. Steel while stopping short of calling again for continued domestic ownership. We're also watching Meta Platforms deploying a new homegrown chip to help power its artificial intelligence services. Plus, Taiwan Semiconductor Manufacturing, or TSMC's, quarterly revenue grew at its fastest pace in more than a year. Back here at home, BMI, a unit of Fitch Solutions, sticking to its forecast for 75 basis points of rate cuts by the Banco Central to still materialize in the second half of this year, despite sticky inflation, and bets that the Federal Reserve will likely start cutting later and less. The BSP left its benchmark policy rate unchanged at a near 17-year high of 6.5% just this Monday, despite a second month of acceleration in CPI. BMI notes the recent uptick is due to upside surprises in food prices and will prompt the BSP to stand pat again when it meets on May 16th or until inflation is more firmly anchored within its target range of 2-4%. It adds, sustained resilience in the economy and weakness in the peso will also mean that the BSP will be in no hurry to loosen monetary policy and instead continue taking cues from the Fed and cut rates only when the Fed does so. Now, on the currency, the Philippine peso has depreciated against the greenback by about 3.1% in the year to date, with uncertainty surrounding the interest rate trajectory in the U.S. leading to much volatility in many emerging market currencies. But BMI notes any preemptive loosening could exacerbate weakness in the peso, something that the BSP will be mindful to avoid. And we have this just in. This is from the Asian Development Banks, their ADB Outlook report for April 2024. They actually lowered Philippine GDP forecast to 6% this year, coming from their earlier ADO report from December, which expected this year to see a growth of 6.2. So they lowered it to 6%. They're also seeing the Philippine economy growing 6.2% for next year. All right. And this is their outlook. This is for the Asian Development Outlook, April 2024. For developing Asia, where the Philippines is included, as you can see, the forecast is for this year, we are growing, the region at least, 4.9% and steady at 4.9 still for next year. Let's take a look at the next chart. I think the next chart is for inflation. There you go. They're expecting inflation for developing Asia, which also includes the Philippines, to ease this year, averaging 3.2% for 2024, easing further to 3% in 2025. Again, zeroing in on the Philippines, the Asian Development Outlook report for April this year, lowering its growth forecast for the Philippines this year to 6% instead of the initial expectation of 6.2% growth. Now that 6.2% we will see not this year, but next year, 2025. A lot of breaking news. We also have this just in. Unemployment in the Philippines hitting 3.5% in February. It actually eased from, let's see, 4.5% in January. That is equal to 1.8 million jobless Filipinos. Well, underemployment, which covers those who have jobs but still want an additional job or hours of work, which is an indicator really of the quality of work, is at 12.4%, also easing from 13.9% in January. The jobs report, let's shift our focus to wage issues. According to think tank Ibon Foundation, across all regions in the country, the average minimum wage as of March is only 440 pesos, or just a little over one-third of the average family living wage for a family of five, which is 1,207 pesos. Family living wage refers to the amount of family income needed to provide for the cost of living, which includes food and non-food requirements. The think tank adds the low wages and incomes of many Filipinos are not enough to keep up with the rising costs in basic goods and services. To talk to us more about that, we have with us Ibon Foundation's Executive Director, Sunny Africa. Hi, Sunny. Welcome back to Market Edge. Good morning.
Hi, morning, Mimi.
Sunny, great timing to have you on the show. We just got our jobs report, unemployment and underemployment rates, both easing in the month of February from January. But when you look at the charts that you have, it doesn't add up.
It kind of adds up if we reinterpret the figures properly. The thing about employment in the Philippines, because we have so much informality, even among wage earners, being employed doesn't mean being gainfully employed. So I think that's one important qualification in terms of the quality of work. Unfortunately, even what you mentioned about underemployment, it's an indirect measure of the quality of work. But unfortunately, if people, despite needing more work, have stopped looking for more work because they know it's nowhere to be found, even if they do objectively need more work, they wouldn't be counted as underemployed. So I think even the 12% or so underemployment rate, that's not right now a precise indicator of the quality of jobs. If anything, it shows that there are so poor job prospects. There are Filipinos who are looking for work, who want more work, but aren't looking because they know it's a waste of their effort. And I think
so. What are they doing if they're not looking?
They're struggling to make do with what they have. I think like you said, it's good timing. The government, since the end of last year, has been talking about supposedly the lowest unemployment rate since about 2005. I think at the same time, they should accept that even the Banco Central, the number of families without savings has increased actually by 600,000 in 2023. Over 19 million families don't have savings. Self-rated poverty surveys, private, more frequent than the government, has noted an increase in the number of poor and borderline poor Filipinos to, I think, as of last count, about 22 million. So basically, at the end of last year, when the government was saying that unemployment is the best in about 20 years since 2005, the number of families without savings, the number of families self-declaring themselves as poor, borderline poor, has increased to about 7 to 8 of Filipino families. And I think that's the bottom line right now. The numbers add up. They only don't add up if we think that being employed means earning enough to not be poor.
Huh, all right. Being employed and gainfully employed, a world of a difference. Sunny, I want to pull up a graphic. So let's start with an interesting one. Let's start with those living in Metro Manila, the NCR family living wage. You're saying that a family of five, a family of five living in Metro Manila should receive a wage of 1,197 per day or 26,000 per month to live decently. Mm-mm.
Yes, we computed that. We were inflating the official figures by the National Wages and Productivity Council. Unfortunately, for some inexplicable reason, the NWPC, an agency of the Department of Labor, stopped computing the family living wage in September 2008. Mm-hmm. What we have been doing basically is that not just in NCR, across all 17 regions, the last official family living wage in 2008, we've been inflating it with the monthly officially reported inflation rates, and that's how we got the current NCR rate of 1,197 compared to the actual minimum wage of 610 pesos.
So you really cannot have a single income household. It doesn't make sense. It's not possible.
You can't have a single income household, and unfortunately, even in Metro Manila, which has the highest minimum wage of, across the regions, you can't even have two minimum wage earners and then and reach the family living wage. I mean, it's a problem not just in Metro Manila. I think it's much more problematic in the regions. Like I said, the 610 peso minimum wage is the highest in Metro Manila. The average minimum wage is only 440 pesos, but the average family living wage is about 1,207 pesos across 17 regions. So like you mentioned earlier, that wage gap of about 762 pesos, that's felt most keenly in outside Metro Manila, and those most beneficial, well, not really beneficial, those doing best aren't doing actually that well in NCR.
Huh, all right, because, and you broke it down, you've got food expenses, house rental value, water, electricity, gas, miscellaneous goods, transport, furnishing, communications, health expenses, savings. Well, savings is at 400. Alcoholic beverages, education, special family occasion. Good that they still have budget for special family occasion, durable furniture, equipment, clothing, and footwear. And with inflation proving to be stickier than initially hoped for, are you expecting these numbers to worsen for the rest of the year?
Unfortunately, yes. The record of the Philippines in terms of minimum wages is pretty bad. We have been tracking minimum wages since 1989, actually since 1987. I don't think very many people know that the average minimum wage, the real minimum wage now, is actually less than in 1989 or 35 years ago. Only NCR has seen a slight increase by about 0.33% compared to 1989. But I think that's a dramatic problem to have. Out of 17 regions, 16 regions have lower minimum wages now in real terms than in 1989. And the only increase is a negligible increase of 0.3% in NCR. And in all likelihood, when the inflation figures come out, the next month's inflation figures come out, even that 0.3% will probably be wiped out. And by next month, categorically, we'll be very definite. Minimum wages in the Philippines are lower than they were in 1989 in real terms, adjusting for inflation.
Huh. So do you support the calls to increase the national minimum wage, 600 per month to be added?
Actually, yes, we are. IBON has been participating in all wage hearings in Congress, and we did present our latest data computed using the biggest, I think, enterprise survey by the PSA, the annual survey of Philippine business and industry. It's a survey with about, I think, a sampling size of 38,000. By that survey, as of 2021, the latest figure, less than 11% of total expenses actually goes to compensation, including salaries and benefits. So with less than 11%, of ex- total expenses of all establishments of all sizes across the whole Philippines being on average less than 11%. We believe quite easily the 100 peso wage increase proposed in the Senate, not just the minimum wage earners, even applying that across the board, the 150, the lowest proposed in Congress right now, and actually even the higher wage increases are doable without increasing prices. This is the catch: if only employers take it out of their profits instead of passing it on to consumers. And I think that's a key point right now. A large wage increase is definitely urgent because they're the lowest since 1989. They're even lower than 1989. They're doable if employers accept a small cut in their profits. And actually, they are necessary because, like you said, even if inflation seems to be lower than a year ago, it does still mean that prices are rising and wages of working class families really aren't keeping up with the rising cost of living.
Sunny, I'm going to play devil's advocate here. When you talk to businesses, and many of them are small, medium enterprises, they're saying we can't do that. We cannot take that from profit. We're going to lose money and end up closing or shutting down or just letting go of employees and just preferring to not hire because it's easy to hire but very difficult to fire. And they're saying, why do we have to carry the burden here? I mean, everything else is so expensive doing business in the Philippines. Electricity, which is a big chunk of the cost, is so expensive here. The cost of doing business is high, and then there's corruption. Raw materials, we don't have the strong supply chains and the logistics to give us affordable services. So everything adds up, and we can no longer take this on, an additional wage hike. That's what they're saying. What do you say to that?
I think it would be good if they actually showed their figures, because like I said, Ibon has been attending the hearings in the House, and it's very striking for us. Whenever the workers speak, there are the numbers. They do show the numbers about the affordability and necessity for wage hike. But when businesses present their case, it's usually a statement that is taken at face value. So I think it's very hard. I mean, we have like hundreds of thousands, over a million enterprises in the Philippines. It is, of course, very hard to generalize across all of them. But it's very, very striking for us, even in discussions with the usual wage boards. Why does it seem to be enough for an employer to say, we can't afford it, for the government to say, okay, you can't afford it? For our basic point is, if it is really unaffordable, I think the employers should show their books. And again, to be clear, Ibon's computation is based on the annual survey of Philippine business industry. It's a survey of 38,000 firms. The names of firms are suppressed, so there's no getting internal information. Using the biggest survey of establishments in the Philippines, the latest survey in 2021, is like post-COVID, so they were just recovering. For instance, the 100 peso wage hike proposed by the Senate, even if applied across the board, not just on minimum wage earners, for micro enterprises, it's only equivalent to 7.9% of their profits. For small enterprises, it's 7.6%. For medium enterprises, even less, 6.7%, also 6.7% for large. So we would argue, again, it's very difficult to generalize across all firms, but taking them collectively, it does seem that they can afford much higher wage hikes than being passed right now by the regional wage boards. All hence, right. They need to go to Congress.
Fair point. We hope we could invite some of these employers to share their numbers. Anyways, Sunny, I wanted to pull in the other graphics from Ibon Foundation because we have some viewers who have been asking to see, you know, the comparison between the minimum wage and the family living wage per region, which you talked about earlier. I think we can pull out that graphics now. You actually listed down. Okay, we're trying to pull in the graphics. Yeah. No, it's the other one. Okay, anyways, you have a map of the Philippines and you ranked it NCR, CAR, all the way to BARMM. And really, the biggest gap, apparently, is in BARMM. Not surprising. Not surprising.
But that is crazy, though, isn't it?
It is.
We looked at the family living wage in BARM in September 2008. Again, the last official figure by the NWBC, using a simple process of applying the inflation rate, the CPI, since 2008. It's crazy. The family living wage in BARM is almost 2,100 pesos. Yet, they have the lowest minimum wage of about 361 pesos. So I think it's... But the thing is, I want to stress one thing. If that chart, if you look at it, most regions actually cluster around the 1,100 to 1,200 peso family living wage. The outliers are just, I think, Region 8 and BARM. But taking out those two outliers, I think this is this graph is important because it affirms that there is actually a basis for national minimum wage, like we did have before 1989. And the statements that conditions are so different between regions, it tends to be exaggerated, again, apart from two or three outliers. So I think it is important to get the national minimum wage. Workers shouldn't have to be competing in the race to the bottom to be, you know, in a region with the highest wages. And I think there is a strong case for right now a national minimum wage. And right now, pegging it at the family living wage, it's about 1,207 pesos average nationwide.
All right. On that note, Sunny, pleasure to speak with you. Thank you so much for humanizing, giving us the human side of these numbers that we talk about so often. Thank you again for the time and the insights. We'll see you soon.
Thanks, Amy. Morning.
All right. Philippine transport officials in talks with bus firm Victory Liner to establish an integrated exchange terminal in northern Metro Manila, similar to the Parañaque Integrated Terminal Exchange, or PTEX. Transport Secretary Jimmy Bautista says it's considering a public-private partnership model for that project, which will be set up on the bus company's 7-hectare property. Aside from this, the Bautista says the government is planning for a bigger project in Taguig, this time with the Ayala Group. In other news, the Metro Manila Council has just passed a resolution shifting work hours in government offices from the current 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. The 8 to 5, that's moving a little bit earlier by an hour to 7 a.m. until 4 in the afternoon. Of course, in a bid to ease road conditions during peak hours, that shift will take effect on April 15, that is next Monday. The local government of Mountain Province urged to be cautious after a blacklisted firm almost bagged over 8 million pesos for an irrigation project. A commission and audit report reveals two of the three small-scale irrigation projects in the province were originally awarded to ADL General Construction in August 2023, but it was later discovered that the firm was included in the blacklist report of the Government Procurement Policy Board. In the meantime, we're now showing you live footage from the Philippine Stock Exchange. Counting down, let's listen in.
2, 1. Congratulations once again to Double Dragon Corporation on celebrating 10 years as a publicly listed company. Thank you to our on-site and virtual guests for joining us.
There you go. Congratulations to Double Dragon, 10 years as a listed company. Of course, this celebration comes ahead of its listing on the NASDAQ later this year. It just signed a merger deal with a SPAC company there to list on the NASDAQ, giving it a valuation of, I think, $2.3 billion. That is not for Double Dragon. That's Double Dragon's Hotel 101 subsidiary. But for Double Dragon, for those who have been watching this stock over the last 10 years, we remember that it sold, its IPO was priced at 2 pesos per share. The offer size was at 1.16 billion pesos, right at the maximum level considered by the property developer. Of course, this is a joint venture between Mang Inasal founder, Edgar Injapsia, and Jollibee Group founder Tony Tan Caktiong, and they're now considered among the country's property powerhouses given the strong demand for the offer. Again, it was a very strong IPO. I remember oversubscribed. They're saying it was 14 times oversubscribed at that time. Congratulations again. Since then, you know, this partnership between Injapsia and Tony Tan Caktiong has blossomed into other ventures. This celebration of their 10th year listing anniversary at the Philippine Stock Exchange happening at a time or ahead of that listing for one of their subsidiaries, Hotel 101 Global, on the NASDAQ. Now, Here is a quick look at the other stories we're tracking in the newsroom today. As we reported, President Marcos is now in Washington for that historic trilateral summit with the U.S. and Japan. On the agenda today is a visit to the Philippine Embassy there, a press conference with National Secretary Communications Advisor John Kirby, and a visit to the Joint Base Andrews Airport. Now, we're also covering COPE Thunder Philippines 2024. That's the military exercises between the Philippines and the U.S. Armed Forces happening at Basa Air Base in Florida Blanca, Pampanga. Happening within the hour, the USAID also holding a roundtable discussion with NEDA and the Philippine Competition Commission over artificial intelligence. While at 10 a.m., we already announced this, but they're officially releasing the numbers and doing a press briefing for the Asian Development Bank release of the Asian Development Outlook for April 2024, where they're going to give their thoughts on forecasts and projections for the Philippine economy, which we already announced. They actually lowered their growth forecast for this year from 6.2% in their initial estimates to 6%. But we are growing 6.2, but that's for next year, 2025. For 10 o'clock, we're also expecting transport groups to hold a press conference as the consolidation deadline for the POV modernization program nears. We are going on a quick break. Coming up, the PSEI's opening numbers following that two-day holiday break with Abby Chu of BDO Securities. Don't go anywhere. Market Edge. We'll be right back. You're still watching Market Edge. The headlines, all eyes at the White House as leaders of the U.S., Japan, and the Philippines meet for a historic trilateral summit. Tokyo and Washington seem to invest at least $100 billion in the Philippines over the next 5 to 10 years. And three sons of Hamas leader Ismail Haniyeh killed in an Israeli airstrike in the Gaza Strip. Philippine shares coming back online today after a two-day break, getting their first chance to react belatedly to the BSP's hawkish pause that came out after trading hours on Monday. To be fair, it was expected. The PSE index kicking off from 67.41. We were down less than a tenth of 1% for Friday. Joining us this morning for more in the markets is Abby Chu. She's head of research at BDO Securities. Hi, Abby. Good morning.
Hi, good morning, Mimi.
All right, Abby, just wanted to bring in the opening numbers, the PSEI in the red from the get-go. We're about 9 minutes into trade. The index is down right now by half of 1%, 36 points. We're at 67.05. It looks like it's going to be a challenge to defend the 6,700 level. Everybody's in the red except for three. Some indices, mining and oil, which is up half a percent, services up by 0.4, and holding firms up by a tenth of 1%. Of course, Abby, the big story today globally is the hotter-than-expected March CPI print for the U.S., rattling Wall Street. Are you expecting big ripples here in Asia, the Philippines in particular, or do you think there are other local factors moving the needle here?
Yes, market will certainly react to the number from and will continue to monitor risks to the inflation outlook. Locally, given that the worries that El Nino and geopolitics will continue to exert price pressures on key commodities like rice and oil and delay the anticipated rate cuts from central banks. And the concern is that prolonged periods of high inflation and interest rates will somehow weaken consumption demand, economic growth, and corporate earnings. However, hopes of easing inflation in the second half were in central banks are largely expected to start lowering borrowing costs may help restore market sentiment for equities. Additionally, Philippine GDP growth estimates of 5.5 to 6% are still better than most economies, and this bodes well for Philippine stocks. Mm-hmm. We also are looking ahead for earnings reports in the subsequent quarters, which may help improve sentiment as we expect most sectors to still deliver double-digit earnings growth, especially for the conglomerates, property, consumer, and power sectors. In fact, we recently raised our base case and 2024 PSEI target to 7,300 from 7,000 previously, as we recalibrated our 2024 earnings growth estimate to 10.5 from 9.1% previously following the fourth quarter earnings season.
All right. What are you seeing that made you upgrade the corporate earnings average growth for this year to 10.5 from just 9.1?
Yeah, so far we know that companies have been proactive in mitigating the impact of high inflation and interest rates. So they have continued to innovate and provide products and services that are relevant to their target market, while also keeping expenses at manageable levels in order to maintain profit margin. So they've been very creative in terms of developing products or services that they see where demand is.
Mm-hmm. You did talk about inflation easing, expected to ease by this year. I wanted to bring in the ADO, Asian Development Bank Outlook report for 2024 of April. They're actually expecting inflation this year to ease average, at least average inflation this year to ease to 3.8% from 6% last year and ease further to 3.4% to 2025. So I wonder, when you also mentioned BSP earlier, you're widely expected, the central banks are widely expected to cut second half of this year. How much are you pricing in? How much do you think is the market pricing in? Because Fitch Solutions Unit BMI just said they're expecting still 75 basis point cuts from the BSP starting the second half.
Yes, I think from what Governor Rensch on last Friday, I think they're still looking at possible rate cuts in the third quarter, assuming inflation cooperates. And we also have a view, it's also consistent with our view that rate cuts could possibly start in the third quarter.
How deep will the cuts be?
Yeah, we are also looking at a first 25 basis point cut in latter part of third quarter, and then possible two cuts follow up in the fourth quarter.
So it's also at 75 basis point cut.
Yes.
All
assuming
right.
Inflation cooperates.
That's a very big assumption. It's so hard. So what is the winning strategy for investors at this point?
Yes, I think for investors, second quarter will really be volatile and maybe looking to buy at dips for investors and focus on companies that we think are well positioned to benefit from the potential uplift in consumption and investments as inflation starts to come down and interest and investment starts to pick up towards the latter part of the year.
Mm-hmm. All right, so it's going to be a good year still. Mm-hmm. I mean, you did upgrade your year-end forecast, 7.3. Yeah. I think we are now, okay, we do have one interesting corporate story. This one is from Mondanisian, the maker of Skyflakes and Lucky Me. They're saying that the Mondanisian is reallocating unused IPO proceeds from a few years back, totaling $229 million to CapEx this year for Asia Pacific branded food and beverage segment. Mm-hmm. Consumer names, you did say you're bullish on consumer products. Given your outlook on inflation, are you optimistic about a consumer name such as Mondanisian?
Yes, I think the general view is still for input costs to continue going down, and this is positive for the margins for consumer names and also translates to stronger earnings. So I think that they're allocating CapEx to prepare for the anticipated increase in demand, so they'll be able to support the growth in their businesses.
And hopefully they did not hedge when prices were high, because that was their problem. I think a few quarters ago, they locked in the prices of commodities at high prices. So when the commodities started to go down, they were trapped in the high price range. All right, I think we're now ready for your blind item. Abby, what do you have for us today? This is a stock that you're watching closely and that you like. Go ahead.
Okay. All right, so this company's share price has started to recover in April, likely on prospects for higher power demand and spot prices during the summer months. We are also optimistic with regards to the sustained expansion of its power portfolio as its industry as the industry aims to increase renewable energy capacity. The group also announced plans to venture into cleaner fuels through a joint venture with a power distributor. So the stock also remains undervalued. I think it's trading at 7.6 times forward PE or forward price to earnings versus the 10 times sector average. And I think only 10.4 times for the PSEI index.
All right, we're just going to have to guess which stock this is. Abby, pleasure speaking with you. Thank you so much for joining us today and for the insights.
Thank you.
All right, see you soon. Now, moving on to other news, the Supreme Court upholds the arbitral ruling ordering Camp John Hay Development Corporation to vacate a portion of the John Hay Special Economic Zone, at least from the Basis Conversion Development Authority. In effect, Camp John Hay Development is ordered to return to BCDA the 247-hectare leased property together with all improvements made, while BCDA in turn must refund to Camp John Hay its total rent paid amounting to 1.4 billion pesos. It was the Philippine Dispute Resolution Center Arbitral Tribunal that had found that both Camp John Hay and the BCDA were guilty of breaches of their obligations under their lease agreement, which warranted its mutual rescission. Singapore-based startup HydroLeap vows to revolutionize wastewater treatment in the Philippines. HydroLeap recently teamed up with local company BioCare to deploy advanced water treatment solutions across various industries in the country. The company claims its electrochemical techniques can reduce up to 95% pollutants present in industrial wastewater.
Existing state of art of the wastewater treatment is pretty much conventional. Like it's the same technology as 50 years ago, 100 years ago. It makes it really difficult to make it happen to be able to, you know, bring that water back to the cycles. So either a lot of companies, they try to go around it or discharge the wastewater to the rivers, to the sea, which is currently you see in a lot of even areas of the Philippines, how much environmental impact that has. So basically what we do, we have come up with this, which you can see currently in the video as well. We have come up with this very modularized electrolysis-based technology, which does not use chemicals, and it uses a very, very small amount of electricity. You're making the wastewater treatment much more smaller, and also we are making it less footprint. Mm-hmm. So with that, we make it more reliable or more available.
Nonprofit organization Go Negosyo aims to expand its youthpreneur program to reach more students across the Philippines. Its founder, Joey Concepcion, made this remark following a successful youthpreneur event at a school in Pasig City, where about 1,000 students and 50 mentors participated. The program aims to equip learners with the various skills necessary to start a business. This initiative is part of efforts to boost the Philippines' small and medium-sized enterprises industry.
Hindi lang pang summer itong programa ng Youthpreneur. It's gonna happen annually, no? And we are going to reach as many schools as possible. Kaya yung DepEd dito, ang malaking bagay sa pag really putting us, you know, we're bringing the private sector that ngayon, on top of private sector helping micro, small, and medium enterprises, now the private sector is going to help yung mga high school students, no? Yung mga senior high, to start already thinking on how to have an entrepreneurial mindset.
And entrepreneurs, taxpayers, listen up. There are 5 days left before the deadline to file and pay your annual income tax returns. The Bureau of Internal Revenue reminds the public the filing of tax returns for 2023 should be done electronically through eBIR forms or EFPS downloadable through the BIR website. Well, manual filing will be allowed only if the electronic platforms are not available and for a certain group of taxpayers, including senior citizens or persons with disabilities. The BIR has set a collection target of 3 trillion pesos for 2024. Now, over the past few weeks, there has been a surge in viral deepfake videos featuring prominent TV personalities, raising the question of whom or what we should be trusting online. In this report by Andrea Taguines, an AI expert provides insights into identifying signs of video manipulation. Take a look.
Magandang morning, Doc, Michelle, and welcome to Sakto. Trinay ko yung hormone balance and it's actually doing great sa akin kasi nawala yung hot flashes. Nawala yung
Kapamilya host Ami Perez joins a string of Filipino TV personalities that have been used for deep fakes or videos manipulated with the use of artificial intelligence or AI. In a sponsored post on Facebook, Perez is made to appear as if she's endorsing a drug for women dealing with menopause.
Nag-appear siya sa feed ng isang kaibigan ko. Pinadala niya yung link sa akin. Tapos sabi niya, Mars, ikaw ba to? Talaga ako pinakinggan ko. Parang boses ko talaga. Ang galing, di ba? Pero sobrang nakakatakot.
The video used was a real interview from Perez's previous morning show on DZMM Teleradio, but was edited towards the end. Perez asserts neither she nor the doctor she spoke with had mentioned any product during their whole exchange. The said drug, called Hormobalance, is not actually registered with the Food and Drug Administration. That's why Perez warns her followers against buying it.
Hindi ko tinetake yung gamot na yon ever. Ang nakakalungkot doon, ang daming babaeng nag-comment na puro tinatanong nila magkano yung produkto.
An AI expert points out the splicing of the video is one of the telltale signs that it's fake. There are also parts where the movements of the speaker's lips are not in sync with the audio track.
Parang siyang dinub. In fact, that was where this technology started for dubbing purposes, to make the dubbed videos more natural.
According to Ligot, there are also times when scammers just loop one clip over and over.
Parang paulit-ulit yung ulo niya in the same direction. That's another known tactic. Kunyari, yung video clip mo is only 3 seconds, pero yung audio clip mo is maybe half a minute. Paulit-ulit lang yung galaw.
Filipinos can also catch deep fakes by listening for weird pronunciation of words or intonation.
Kunyari, pesos becomes pesos kasi nga these technologies were developed in English.
But as AI technology evolves, Ligot said it will only get harder to distinguish edited videos from real ones. His advice,
kailangan kinikilatis mo, ano bang narinig ko? Totoo ba yan? And we have to adopt yung mas skeptical na attitude. Usually yung mga common parang ano dyan eh, mga common uses dyan. Either it's a political message or may binibenta, like hard selling. You should automatically parang ano, scrutinize.
Ligot also encouraged the public to report such videos to social media sites, to authorities, and to the person being impersonated. And instead of believing online ads, the Department of Health said it's always better to consult with a doctor for their medical concerns. In a statement, DOH Secretary Ted Herbosa said his agency will continue to file cases against online pages making use of the DOH and FDA logos to trick people.
Wala po kaming ini-endorso kahit ni isang produkto, kahit gamot, kahit pagkain, wala po. So ibig sabihin, pag may nakita po kayo na nagsasabing DOH endorses this, dun pa lang ho, wag na kayong maniwala.
Just recently, the videos of some ABS-CBN journalists and anchors were also manipulated to look like they were endorsing a slimming treatment. Andrea Taguines, ABS-CBN News.
Magandang morning, Ms. Ami.
Time now to zip through the top headlines from major business papers from Business World. Makoto Tsuchiya, an economist at Oxford Economics, believes the Philippines' lowered economic growth target is still optimistic. He notes the downgrade brought the target to a more plausible range, considering headwinds, including high inflation and slowing global economy. Last week, Philippine economic managers revised lower the GDP target range for this year to 6-7% from the initial 6.5-7.5%. From Business Mirror, the Philippine Bureau of Treasury says revenues raised by the privatization in management units rose to a total of 231 million pesos between January and February this year. That's nearly 10 times what it collected in the same period last year. And from the Philippine Daily Inquirer, Philippine authorities retrieving more than 5.5 million pesos in cash and 25,200 pesos worth of foreign currencies from vaults that they opened in several buildings of a Philippine offshore gaming operator, or POGO, in Bamban, Tarlac, during raids done on Monday and Tuesday. Now, here's a quick look at the flash business headlines from overseas. Apple supplier Foxconn said to be considering introducing a rotating chief executive system in a major overhaul of its management structure that's supposed to help it grow future talent, promote teamwork, and prevent leadership from becoming entrenched. Sources say the plan is a response to investors' calls to boost corporate governance by separating the role of chief executive from the chairman. In other news, the U.S. Department of Justice has reportedly opened an antitrust investigation into Nippon Steel's $14.1 billion takeover of U.S. Steel. The deal has faced a lot of scrutiny over national security concerns, with President Joe Biden himself saying last month that U.S. Steel must remain an American steel company that is domestically owned and operated. But here is a deal that's getting a lot of support. U.S. President Joe Biden and Japanese Prime Minister Fumio Kishida pledging to intensify efforts to harness the power of the wind amid concerns in Japan over access to liquefied natural gas or LNG. This comes after the Biden administration's January move to suspend the approval of new licenses to export U.S. LNG while it reviews how these shipments impact climate change, surprised Japan's top importers. And former U.S. President Donald Trump no longer listed on the Bloomberg Billionaires Index, which is a daily ranking of the world's 500 richest people. That's after the stock price for Trump Media, the parent company behind his social media company Truth Social, took a nosedive. Trump Media ended Wednesday at $34.26 apiece, down more than 50% since their peak and debut in March. Forbes listed Trump's net worth at $4.6 billion as of Wednesday afternoon, making him just the 696th richest person in the world. 696, still good, though not inside the 500. And finally, an affiliate of Dalia and Wanda Group has agreed to sell James Bond's yacht maker, Sunseeker, to Lionheart Capital. The transaction, which is subject to British regulatory approval, is poised to close as soon as next month. And for those who tried to guess your blind item for the day, it's very cheap, according to Abby Chu, and it's going to benefit from the very hot weather outside, the demand to cool your homes as you try to beat the heat. This stock is, drumroll please, Aboitiz Power. Do listen if you got that. Do tweet us at ANC Alerts. In the meantime, that's it for the show. I'm Michelle Long. Thank you so much for watching. Stay safe and stay with ANC.